Harvest, this is my good friend Anthony Honore. He currently serves as an elder in our church. He's been attending the Niles campus since 2011, and this is his story.
Born and raised on the south side of Chicago. Fourth grade is when my dad left. You know, just over time, I developed what we would say a nice knuckle game where, you know, I began to learn how to fight and defend myself. Eighth grade really was a game changer for me. It's when I got involved with gangs, began to drink, smoke weed, smoke cigarettes. I was really just sucked in and loved the streets, loved the people who were running the streets, and those were the guys that I grew up looking up to.
So after high school, you were still in this gang and heavily involved in that, and kind of your life is going further and further downhill, but you got a job that really was pretty influential in your story.
A friend of mine recommended a job. There was an opening for a warehouse position there at the company. Met a beautiful young lady by the name of Nura. She would walk past as I was in the cafeteria, and I would literally gawk. And my eyes would follow her as she walked past. She walked up to me and was like, you know, it's really not polite to stare at people. You should really say hi.
That's pretty direct.
Yeah. And that's kind of what started our friendship, if you will. I was totally into her, obviously. Her into me, not so much. I was able to open up to her and tell her things that I hadn't really shared with anybody.
So this person you just met is becoming somebody that you're opening up to more than anybody else.
Yeah, absolutely.
Your whole life, probably.
For sure.
And then she invited you to church?
Yeah, so the pitch was, if you can come hang out on Saturday nights, then you can come to church with me on Sunday.
All right.
Month after month after month went by, and just hard-hearted. I was only interested in her, obviously. Really wasn't interested in anything that the church
had. Any of the messages that you were hearing, nothing was really penetrating?
Nothing at that point had penetrated my heart or my thinking or anything. Continued to attend because I wanted to win the affection of this young lady.
So even while you're going to church with her and getting to know her a little better, this Christian friend, there was something darker happening inside your own heart, right?
I had become addicted to crack cocaine. What I had been selling, tried it, and there was no looking back. My friends didn't know, the gang didn't know, my family didn't know, and I hadn't even shared it with Nura. Parked my truck in my mom's garage with just the dome light on and just get high all night. There were several times I sat in my car, gun in lap, just thinking to myself, like, I should just end it. Like, there's got to be more to life than what I'm doing. And was just really at a place of brokenness. Several times, taking the gun and actually putting it to my head, and just this nagging feeling of, there's got to be more to life than this. There's got to be more to life than this. And that would just play, and I would not do it. And so that plagued me for quite a while. But again, just wasn't open about it. With my friend Nura at that time. She used to cry out during service to the Lord for my soul. And as time went on, you know, again, the guy that's like this, who comes enough, eventually arms are down, and eventually, you know, you get, you know, one of these, praise the Lord, to eventually like this.
So you confess Christ at that church?
Absolutely. The day that I confessed Christ, preacher was preaching in John chapter 15. John 15, 13 says, greater love has no one than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you. Part of the gang handshake, the gang that I was in, we would, you know, part of it was you beat your chest. And what that symbolized is, I'll die for you. And it was in that moment again that in my mind, I'm running back scenarios of, man, he didn't die for me there. He ran. I ran. But what I found to be true that day was that Jesus did it.
Yeah.
For the remainder of the service, my head was in my lap and I was crying out.
And Nura was right next to you.
Nura was right next to me and just overjoyed. And it was at that moment, that verse, that day, that minute took me to the mat. Something in me changed the day that I confessed Christ, and I immediately went to the south side. I went scared, thinking that, you know, harm could possibly come my way. maybe even death. And so the person that I went to talk to, when I explained to him, man, I just accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior, his words to me were, if anybody says anything or tries to do anything to you, like, let me know and I'll put the word out that people don't mess with you.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And so I got a clean break. I mean, literally a clean break from that day, from the lifestyle that I had been living for 20 some odd years.
So now tell us a little bit about Nura and what happened there with the relationship.
What she had seen before me coming to Christ and what I was like after coming to Christ was two totally different people, and she recognized that. So things escalated quickly. We began dating and got saved in April. We got engaged in December of that same year, and then married in July 3rd the following year. I'm now reconciled with my dad, and this happened at my grandmother's funeral, where he didn't even know that his children were gonna show up, and we showed up, and I got a chance to sit across the table from my dad and say, Dad, I forgive you.
So Anthony, you're now giving leadership to our counseling ministry on the Niles campus, and you're serving as an elder. And so, you know, tell us a little bit about, you know, how that's been a blessing to you.
My wife and I are just so grateful that we get to just share some of the pain that we've gone through and pointing people to God's word. No matter what circumstances you've come through, no matter what you're currently going through, like, there's hope in Jesus Christ. And to be able to do that on a regular basis, and not only do it, but to see lives changed by the gospel, to see lives changed by God's word, and to see believers who may be struggling now walking strong, making disciples, is such a privilege that my wife and I get to serve the Lord in that way.